Please stand by. The presentation will begin shortly.
Hi, everyone. This is Laura Shiombola. I'll be your moderator for Black Women Disrupting the Status Quo in Technology today, presented by Mozilla Foundation and Spelman. I'm really excited and honored to be in dialogue with three trailblazing women who have done incredible work in the tech space. I have with me Aerica Shimizu Banks, who's worked with Obama, Biden, Google, and others to develop inclusive tech policy. Meredith Brossard, who is the author of Artificial Unintelligence, How Computers Misunderstand the World. She also teaches computational journalism and data-driven journalism at NYU, and she was featured in the film Coded Bias. And then we have Erica Hairston, tech disruptor and thought leader, who raised $1.4 million as co-founder of Edlift after working at LinkedIn and Facebook. So please help me welcome these genius women to the panel. Thank you, Mozilla, for having us. Thank you, Spelman. I'm really honored to be here today. So I'm really excited for this conversation because, as we all know, tons of headlines about how Black women and are underrepresented in the VC world. Black people are underrepresented in the tech world. We don't have enough opportunities to enter companies like Google and Facebook and LinkedIn. And so when you do find Black women holding space and disrupting, it's incredibly inspiring. I studied computer science. I was the only Black woman in most every room for about the first decade of my career. So I really resonate with this topic, and currently building NAR Labs, a social enterprise to inspire and operationalize Black liberation through art, tech, and community building. And it's quite a lonely road when you're a Black woman tech founder. So I want you guys to share with us a bit of your journey. What brought you to this work? What drives you? What inspires you? Were there people, were there Black women, were there others in tech who inspired you to enter this space? And if we can start with you, Meredith.
Okay, thanks. It is very exciting to be here speaking with all of you today. So I have been programming ever since I was, I think, 11 years old. My parents got me a computer. It was one of the early Apples. They got me a tutor, and the tutor taught me to write computer programs. And then so I just knew how to write computer programs, and I did that for a long time. I went to Harvard and majored in computer science in the early 90s. And I was one of only six women in computer science. I only knew like two of the others. I couldn't find the other ones. I'm pretty sure I was the only Black woman. I graduated. I worked as a computer scientist. I worked at Bell Labs. I worked at the MIT Media Lab. But I dropped out of computer science for all of the textbook reasons that women leave STEM careers. There was nobody who looked like me. There was no way of contextualizing or understanding why I felt so, so lost and so isolated. And so like, what is going on around me? I didn't understand that this was sexism and racism at work. And so I left. I went into journalism, and then I actually came back to computer science through data journalism, data and computational journalism. So that's the practice of finding stories and numbers and using numbers to tell stories. So I feel really good that I've come back to it. I wish that I had not been edged out in the first place. I'm really glad to be here with all of you because there are so many more Black women who are kind of ahead of you in your careers now. And that's such a great feeling to be able to look ahead and see, oh yes, here is a Black woman who is absolutely rocking it further ahead in her career. And because I'm the very kind of bleeding edge of the generation that has had the internet for their entire adult life, there just aren't that many people there aren't that many Black women who are older than I am who are in computer science, or and there are zero in computational journalism. I'm the first person to go through the entire tenure process to kind of be promoted as a data journalism professor. And I am the only woman of color.
Thank you for your story, Meredith. Please, Aerica Hairston, can you share a bit about your journey into founding EdLift and entering computer science?
Yeah, wow, Meredith, I did not know you started coding at 11. That is so inspiring. So hi, everyone. So excited to be here today. So my journey into tech and becoming a tech founder is actually a little bit different. So I knew nothing about coding when I was going through school, barely understood what Silicon Valley was, and I thought it was magic. But when I got to my senior year of high school, I actually saw a documentary by a women's organization from Stanford called She++. And they interviewed a bunch of women in tech, and they a lot of people who are taking computer science. And they also showed, you know, tech companies like Facebook and LinkedIn. And I just remember thinking to myself as this, you know, 18-year-old Black girl, how could there be so few people who look like me in this industry that is clearly taking over the future of everything? Like, it can't be that hard. Are they shutting us out? I have to try it. And so it was one of those perfect timing things where my mom always jokes, I spent 18 years trying to get you interested in STEM. And it just took, you know, this documentary to, you know, my freshman year as a freshman at Yale to decide to major in computer science and African American studies. And so that's where I took my first coding class, where the way I describe it is it felt like I was getting slapped in the face a bunch of times, where it felt like everyone else had been coding since they were, you know, 2 years old, and there were no other Black people in my classes, especially not Black women. And I remember thinking to myself, I want to be the role model for the future Black women to come and the future, you know, young girls who want to study CS. And I'm doing this for more than myself. And that was the thing that kept me wanting to major in CS. And that my journey into founding EdLift and, you know, working at Facebook and LinkedIn was really just opportunities and network. And this, I know we'll dive deeper into this into the panel, but the way I ended up starting EdLift was because I wanted to solve a problem I experienced for myself. And my first entrance into the startup world was actually building an app that I really wanted to be able to see more role models who I could relate to. And so I literally built an app to do that. I learned Swift through YouTube. And I realized, you know, I was doing this just for myself, but then I had friends saying, I want to use this. Can I download it? And that was the first time I realized I could build something other people wanted. And the more people I spoke to, I realized the bigger impact I could have was helping more people get through computer science classes. And that's how you could create economic opportunity. And so that's how EdLift was founded and where we are today as a team based in the Bay Area. So that's my introduction.
Thank you, Aerica. I'm super curious to know, because I studied computer science undergrad and African studies as a master's, and it was always very strange for people when I would tell them that combination. Can you share with us what made you choose both?
I was so excited when I saw you've also done that combination. So for me, I knew I wanted to start in computer science just because of the reason I said earlier, I wanted to change the stats and be a part of that. And then when I took my first AFAM class, I just remember being like, ooh, this is feeding my soul. Like, I need to be learning more about my history. Why didn't I learn this, you know, in middle school and in elementary school? And I also loved being able to literally go from my data structures class to an African American studies class where I was like, oh, I can use this tool to build something for this problem we discussed. And that combination just felt like a very powerful tool to experience both.
You know what's funny? I also did computer science in FM. So I think there's like, there's something here about that intersection.
That's insane. I feel so nourished to know that there's, you know, two other women who actually thought to do the same thing. Okay, so Aerica Shimizu Banks, I want to give you a chance to share your story. You have had, you know, you've worked on such incredible policy work at Google and with the Obama administration, with the Biden administration. I'd like to hear more about your story and how you came to this work.
Well, compared to the three of you, I'm definitely the outlier here. So it's such an honor and always such a joy to share the stage and be in conversation with other Black women in tech. And so thanks for the opportunity for this, especially being hosted by Spelman. And of course, not to mention Mozilla, but especially Spelman, it's quite an honor. So I came to tech in a bit of a roundabout way. I actually majored in environmental studies, and I think I'm one of the few people who kept their degree the entire time and knew exactly what they wanted to do. And I wanted to do environmental policy. And I think as well, what informed that is I'm sort of the generation of people who sadly, I think, were told that to work on issues of your own identity, so civil rights and African-American studies or issues would pigeonhole you. That was definitely the advice I received early on in my academic career from community members, from my parents. So I wanted to work on social justice issues, but I didn't want to be pigeonholed. And so I felt that environmental studies could be a middle ground. But once I got to my second year of undergrad at a predominantly white institution, I went to college in Seattle and went to a conference on environmental justice, which was this completely new term that I'd never heard of before. It brought together all of the issues I cared about and was afraid to work on, but brought home for me how urgent and essential it was to work on those issues. And that, it's not a problem to specialize in something, especially when it can have such a huge impact on your community and hopefully make the world a better place. So I began to focus on environmental justice as a researcher, an organizer, and then as a policy sort of expert, beginning in Washington State and carrying that over to the Obama administration, where I worked at the Office of Management and Budget on environmental policy issues. And I went to Oxford for an environmental policy master's. And while I was there, while I had total intentions of returning to the White House upon the completion of my 1 year master's, I found myself graduating in the middle of the government shutdown of 2013. And so I had to pivot and figure out something else to do. I applied to all of these environmental nonprofits and foundations, what have you. And no one was getting back to me. So it was suggested that just apply online to a company whose values align with yours. And I applied online to Google, and Google was the only employer that got back to me of everyone I applied to. So I ended up in tech that way. And I found myself working on policy issues again, but this time in patent policy. And I knew nothing about IP, but what I found is that, like with every issue, when you do a little digging, there's a structural racism problem and there is inequity. And after the company had company-wide conversations about the murders of Alton Sterling and Philando Castile, I spoke up about this feigned ignorance from my white colleagues about how racism still persists and if Black people who work in tech are still affected by issues that affect the Black community at large. I was so offended by the concept of this, I couldn't help but sort of burst out and say, I can't believe you guys, this is ridiculous, and share stories about the way in which racism has impacted my family's life, specifically police brutality of my brother and unfair harassment by the police of my father. And I definitely thought I was going to get fired after that conversation. But instead, my director came to me and said, I resonate with what you had to say. I was an Asian man that grew up in Ohio in a predominantly white school. And so, I want to support you in developing this work. And as a result, over 2 years, my team invested $1 million in diversity, equity, and inclusion programs, specifically around innovation and patenting, and making sure to close those gaps in terms of access to entrepreneurs of color and women, and especially women of color, students, et cetera. And from there, I then went to start the office of Pinterest in DC and become their first head of office there and to lead federal policy. But as some of you may know and may have read, I encountered extreme racism and discrimination in that role, along with another Black woman, Ifeoma Ozoma, who's also speaking in this festival and is a Mozilla fellow. And so after coming forward about what we experienced, we've now started our own separate consulting firms, which brings me to Shiso, the consultancy I founded in the middle of the pandemic last year. Like so many Black women, I found myself pushed out of the industry in which I built my career. and decided to start a business and make sure to build my business based on the values I've always held, but also with that particular lens that I think is a real gift that we as Black women have in this field. So I apply that intersectional lens, intersectional equity lens to tech policy and business development.
Wonderful. You've all touched on the need for using technology to solve problems. Meredith writes about it in her book. Erica, you've talked about EdLift using, you know, your platform to make computer science more accessible for people of color. I'd like for us to talk a bit about solutioning and why it's so important that technology is not built by a homogeneous mass of white men.
Yeah, I'm happy to start with that one. I can't stress how important it is for there to be diverse creators, because if we have the same group of people who are building technology and building the tools that for problems that they're experiencing themselves, then there will be so many unsolved problems and so many populations who are being ignored and actively discriminated against. And so that is why personally, I feel so strongly about ensuring that there are women computer scientists and Black computer scientists and Black women computer scientists. And I will say that over and over again, because we will acknowledge and build solutions for problems that we're experiencing that otherwise would go ignored. And I think like one of the personal anecdotes that I have to this, it's kind of relevant, but I remember my first internship at Facebook when I wrote my first line of code. All it did was change a button blue on an Android, on the Android app. And I remember calling my mom and saying like, I did that. I wrote one line of code that is now on a million people's phones. Like that impact is scary and powerful. And there is a responsibility that comes with that skill that makes it so important for different people to have access to understand how it works and to be able to build those solutions. So I just needed to start with that one.
Thank you for that. Does anyone else want to weigh in on that question?
I think that the example of Joy Bolognini is really important here. So there's a film coming out on PBS next week, I think. It's called Coded Bias. Full disclosure, I'm in it. But it covers Joy Bolognini's work about facial recognition and the way that she discovers that facial recognition technology is better at recognizing men than women. It is better at recognizing light skin than dark skin. And it is especially bad at recognizing dark-skinned women. There's been a lot of positive change in response to Joy's work. Facial recognition has been banned in policing in a number of cities. I think we had the first state that passed a facial recognition ban. Joy testified before Congress, and her organization, the Algorithmic Justice League, is doing just amazing work in raising awareness of algorithmic bias and also in algorithmic auditing and bug bounty hunting. So I think that that Joy's work is a really good example of why we need more Black computer scientists, why we need more people from diverse backgrounds and of diverse appearances in tech, because it's been known for a really long time that computer vision is racist. This her work did not come out of nowhere. The Microsoft Kinect, for example, was a video gaming system back in the day. And if you tried to use the Kinect and you were a person with dark skin and the light was low, the Kinect would not recognize you. There are other things like, I don't know if you've seen the viral video of the racist soap dispenser. It's a soap dispenser that does not work if you have dark skin, which is particularly bad in a pandemic, I have to say, right? So these are things that white developers do not notice because they're developing for themselves and for other people who look like them. And they're making the assumption that, oh, okay, it works for me. It must work for everybody. But the human experience has wonderful, wonderful variety. And we need to be making technology that works for the vast and exquisite variety of human experience.
And if I could just briefly add to that, you know, in addition to designing for ourselves and, you know, the Black community, which is mostly neglected in tech, when people with diverse backgrounds and experience contribute to design, it's actually better for everyone. So the perspective we bring has better results in better outcomes for all people. This is known as the curb cut effect. And this is about designing for accessibility and folks with handicaps. When they started doing that with the curbs, they noticed, oh, actually, this is also better for a whole host of other people. And that is the effect that we bring to technology. So, you know, in addition to serving our own community, we serve the benefit of all when we are included in the process.
Thank you for that, Aerica. Last year, we faced, you know, a reckoning, the pandemic, and what some people have called, you know, the racial revolution, the racial reckoning. We are now more comfortable talking about race globally. It's not, you know, no longer as much of a hidden away topic. Do you feel that you've seen a shift in the tech ecosystem since 2020? Do you feel that any changes, you know, that the promises that are being made are authentic? Should we expect a complete shift in the tech ecosystem, or what are your concerns currently about that?
Well, I'd be happy to start with a somewhat pessimistic outlook, and that is no. I think superficial overtures of addressing racism have improved. But functional and substantive change is very far off. Sydney Fussell in Wired just published a very compelling article on this, in which he coins the term diversity theater to describe this very conundrum, where there's a lot of superficial overtures, especially in the wake of the murder of George Floyd, where folks were posting black squares, companies felt compelled to release statements. And yet, if we look at statements in support of Black Lives and Black Lives Matter, and yet if we look at the follow-through, Sherelle Dorsey at the Plug Insights is actually tracking every tech company's statement on these issues and whether they've followed through on the pledges of money, support, et cetera. Very few have so far. And, you know, we're past 6 months after that. Thinking about my own experience, what I found is that, you know, like many others, being a Black woman in tech is still very much a tokenized experience. So while folks are adding, you know, one person of color or one woman of color to their board, or there's one exec of color in the C-suite, the experience of employees on the ground is incredibly disheartening. In my case, for example, I was hired to be a face of the company and start their office in DC, represent them to Congress, et cetera. But when I actually advocated for bringing in Black small businesses, you know, those transactions were questioned. Or when I advocated on behalf of subcontractors, many of whom, the majority of whom, as throughout the tech industry, are Black and brown, and in the case of the offices I worked in, also disabled, I was actually sort of, that was the beginning of the end of my time there, and I was retaliated against quite heavily. So, you know, the representational politics in tech may be improving, but what isn't changing is the substance of it. We are not seeing a change in numbers in terms of the demographics of these companies. The demographics in tech are worse than other industries, and by including the private sector at large. And also, if you look at VC funding, in 2020, it actually went down for women and Black women, despite the achievements of Aerica and others. We're a long way off from parity and equality.
And I'm glad you mentioned Aerica, because I wanted to talk a bit about your journey raising money last year, and how you had to sort of translate your answers for the VC community. Can you talk a bit about what that process was like for you fundraising with the 2020 reckoning happening?
Yeah. So Arnell, my co-founder, and I started fundraising actually like a week before the pandemic hit. So a little over a year ago, and we had just finished the Accelerator Y Combinator at that time. And I actually always start this kind of journey with the caveat that as two, you know, young 20-year-old Black women funding for our startup, we went into it knowing we have to be 30 times better because we already knew the odds were stacked against us. Those stats were out there. And so I actually say like that was our biggest strength going into the pandemic, because a lot of other founders, you know, in YC were like, oh my God, what do I do? Whereas we knew it was going to be hard. With that said, however, it was still 10 times harder than I imagined. And some of those, you know, the most difficult parts were one, just having to reiterate over and over again how qualified we are. We had an investor ask us like, how are you gonna be able to build this? Like, can you guys code? We have CS degrees from Yale and Stanford and worked at Google and Facebook and had to learn how to reiterate our qualifications. We had an investor, you know, say our story is too emotional and learn how to bounce back from that, but still stay so close to our values, and learning how to make that balance and sacrifice was really, really challenging. But one of the most tactical things that I learned about this experience was there was a study done that found that women and minority founders are asked different questions than male and white founders. And there's positive questions and negative questions. And they found that women and minority founders who were able to answer those negative questions with a positive answer were actually able to raise as much, like 2 million more than founders who were answering negative questions with negative responses. And so I quite literally had to make a translation. You know, when I'm asked, well, why wouldn't just Google build this? I had to translate in that in my head as, what makes you the best team to build this, and answer it that way. And so that's an example of a question or a biased question that Black women founders would get more than our white counterparts. And so that experience was very, very, you know, trying. And I think the last thing I'll add in terms of, you know, the racial revolution, we actually closed our fundraise on Juneteenth, which was like kind of right in the middle or at the end of that racial reckoning or revolution. And one of the things that I personally struggled with was, you know, around that time, there were people on Twitter saying, you know, Black founders, like, where are you? Let me send you money. Like, quite literally, it felt like capitalizing off of the deaths of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. And there was so much pain at that time, and kind of having to deal with like this struggle that we're all feeling, but also my company needs to succeed, and finding ways to stay true to what I believed in and bring on people who I knew would still be doing this work after this summer was very important to us as well. So that's kind of a few different points from that experience of fundraising.
Thank you, Erica. So Meredith, I'm thinking about your work in computational journalism, and what it might have looked like to document the racial reckoning of last year, the impact of the pandemic on Black people. I'm curious if you've done any work recently to kind of track the changes across the tech ecosystem, looking using computational journalism or, you know, documenting the data. Can you speak to that?
I've actually given up on hoping that tech is going to improve in terms of its numbers. Things have not changed substantially over the entire course of my adult life. My colleague Pamela Newkirk has a really great book called Diversity Inc., which is about the diversity, equity, inclusion industry, and why we have so much lip service devoted to improving diversity, and yet the numbers don't change over time. So tech just keeps saying, oh yeah, we'll do better. Oh, I'm so surprised that we don't have more Black women engineers. Oh, I can't possibly imagine what the problem is. I'm gonna go and, you know, donate to a, you know, Girls Learn to Code organization, which is great. We need Girls Learn to Code organizations. Like, we need so many of them. But we have both a pipeline problem and a culture problem. Girls start to get messages that they are not good at math or science starting as early as third grade. So if you are just funding you know, computer science programs at HBCUs, like you've already lost a whole lot of girls who have been edged out of STEM fields already. So you need to start really early, and you need to have constant support in there. So Aerica Hairston's startup sounds so exciting because of the support that it offers. And we need more organizations like that, and we need them throughout the K through 12 experience, throughout the college experience, throughout the graduate school experience. And then we need a revolution in hiring. We need a revolution in how people do performance reviews. We need people to be less racist and sexist in their everyday lives. We need fewer microaggressions. Like, it's a really big project. So you can't write code for it. And I'm just not tracking it anymore because it's too depressing.
Ouch, ouch. So that brings me to Aerica's work in policy and what the future looks like. We spoke in our last conversation about some of the policy work that's been happening in the Biden administration. I'd like to hear from you and anyone else who could chime in about what you see, you know, what you're hopeful about, what you see shifting across the ecosystem, and particularly for Black women.
Well, I had the opportunity to serve on Biden's Innovation Council as he was running for office in the lead up to the election. What I was really impressed by was how centered equity, racial equity specifically, was in so many of his policies and the administration's policies. And, you know, to add to what, you know, Dr. Brossard and Aerica have said, you know, it's a longstanding problem that tech is not going to solve on its own. And so to that, I think an additional tool in our tool belt is regulation and shareholder lawsuits, because we have policies, we have laws on the books already that are meant to address these very issues. Affirmative action is still a valid policy act, and yet it continues to be challenged, but it's still valid. And so what I'd like to see and what I look forward to is the reinstatement of the EEOC's mandate, more resources for that department to actually pursue now its investigations into the backlog. Apologies for my dog, he's scratching in the background. To the backlog of cases that built up, especially in the previous administration, where they were actively told not to pursue the mandate of their own office. Similarly, with the Department of Labor, they have a huge backlog of investigations to go through into labor violations of these companies. And, you know, President Biden has made a lot of statements in support of strengthening labor laws and labor protections, which I think will have a promising impact, at least on the harm that we are aware of. Proactively, there has to be a lot of changes on the policy side in many ways, as to what Meredith mentioned. One, for example, is, you know, what we choose to measure is a statement of our priorities as a society. And many government agencies do not track demographic data in applications for things, in reception of funding, et cetera. And so what we saw with, you know, the small business grants of PPP, et cetera, many entrepreneurs of color were shut out of this. And part of it is because there was need blind and race blind applications. Similarly, with the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, we have a huge dearth of Black innovators and innovators of color, in part because applications do not count the demographic data of their applicants. And so there's no way to measure, we have no data to measure, okay, how many innovators do we have of color? How many are on these research teams? How many do we want? You cannot manage what you do not measure. And so choosing not to measure these things is a demonstration of our values. And so while that may not change with this administration, there has been several pieces of legislation, many led by Senator Mazie Hirono, in fact, that tackle this very issue, especially in innovation. And finally, there's the Algorithmic Accountability Act of 2019 that I hope is reintroduced. Senator Cory Booker and Senator Hirono, again, were huge proponents of that, which will address not just not necessarily just the bias in AI, but how AI is funded, how AI is managed, and finally put some oversight in this area that has completely sort of run amok without any sort of oversight from the government. So there is some hope there, but again, it's about our force of will and our values as a society, and we will enforce and we will measure what we deem important. And that is a shift that policy in some ways cannot address.
Aerica, I so agree. I am totally with you. And I love the idea that we need to enforce the laws that are already in place. People so often imagine that we need to write new laws or new policy to regulate AI. They imagine that AI is so special and it just is so transformative that we can't do anything the same that we did before. We got to do everything differently for AI. And it's not at all true. We have really good existing laws and policies. We just need to implement them in the digital sphere. And one of the reasons that we have not done digital enforcement is one of the original sins of the internet. So when the ideas that we have now about technology and society were created, they were created by a very small and homogeneous group of people. They were mostly white male hippies from Stanford and from, you know, Ivy League and Oxbridge organizations. They were on the communes in the 60s, where all of the women, where the communes were primarily white and the women were barefoot, pregnant, and in the kitchen. And the communes failed. But they said, oh, well, the communes failed, but we have this new world of cyberspace and we're going to implement our new communalist values in cyberspace. And so that's where we get the idea that somehow what happens online is different than what happens in the real world. That's where we get the idea that if something happens in cyberspace, then it's not subject to governmental regulations. And it's just wrong. It's just deeply and profoundly wrong. So we need to switch our thinking and we need to not let tech companies get away with violating the law just because they're doing it digitally. One of the ways that we can do this is absolutely through regulation, it's through policy, it's through enforcement, and it's really mundane, unfortunately. Auditing algorithms is something that I do. AJL does it. I do it in partnership with Orca, Kathy O'Neill's consulting company. And it is really detailed work. It is mathematically intense. The way that we do it, you know, makes it an easier lift. But you know, you kind of have to be willing to engage, and it gets a little messy and it's complicated. And it's not so easy that you can just write an app for it. You know, it's a bespoke process. And that's not the kind of thinking that is popular in Silicon Valley. Like in Silicon Valley, we've gotten used to this ideology of, okay, let's identify a pain point. Let's narrow it down to the point where we can write code against it. And then let's write it, deploy it, and then scale it up so you make a bajillion dollars. You know, it's a valid process, but regulation and enforcement is not something that you're going to be able to make $1 billion at. And it's a governmental process. It's something we need to invest in, and it's never going to be glamorous. It's really valid and valuable work, but it's never going to be super glamorous. So I think we need to keep this in mind. So enforce what's already in place. This is not just an individual thing. We can't solve this problem by, you know, everybody putting privacy settings to the highest level on their browsers. It has to be an act of individuals as well as a policy level or a corporate level decision, because as Erica Hairston said, when you write a line of code at Facebook, it gets deployed to millions of people simultaneously. We need to fix this problem of bias in tech for millions of people. We need to fix the problems of data security and data privacy in tech for millions of people. You know, individuals doing it on their own is simply not going to work.
I can't help but think about storytelling as an additional solution. We talked about policy. Meredith, you were featured in Joy Boulamini's film, Coded Bias. I'm curious what you think of the role of storytelling. What is possible? How do we sort of shift that thinking? How do we kind of open up to a different type of, you know, possibility in technology? Are there other Black women who are, you know, disrupting the narrative, who are disrupting the ecosystem that we should highlight in addition to Joy?
I am so glad you asked this. This is one of my favorite things to talk about. So I will try and keep it brief. So one of the things we focus on in data journalism is the need to tell stories in addition to working with numbers. So one of the things I write about is an idea I call techno-chauvinism. It's the idea that tech is superior to other solutions. And you hear a lot that, oh, we should use computers because they're more objective, they're more unbiased. Oh, if we just, if the news were just the facts and just statistics, everybody would make up their minds more easily. It's not at all true. Okay, so we need to push back against techno-chauvinism. And in the news, we need legitimate news media who are paid appropriately, who are professionals, who have ethical, who adhere to ethical codes of conduct and, you know, are not spreading misinformation. And human stories and data and statistics and facts woven together are what makes up a really great story. So you have to pair anecdotes with data in order to kind of really show people what's going on, or in order to change people's minds, or in order to provide clarification. So storytelling is so crucial. One of the things we can do is we can have a more diverse range of voices telling these stories. And also, if you are a writer, you can do a source audit and make sure you're not just talking to the usual suspects. This is not easy. There's no software to do it, but if you do it with the kind of manual stuff that you need to do, then you can get a better perspective on who are you talking to, and are you talking to a variety of voices. In terms of other women whose stories are going to be appealing, Timnit Gebru is an amazing, amazing AI ethics researcher who was just fired from Google scandalously. And her co-lead, Margaret Mitchell, was fired 5 weeks later. It's a big scandal. There's a huge story about it in the New York Times today by Kate Metz that mirrors the story that you see in Coded Bias. Joy Boulamini is in the story as well, Deb Raji. So definitely check out the work of all of these amazing women. Another organization to check out is Data for Black Lives. Yashima Bet Milner is an amazing, inspiring woman who is working on the data side and working on the policy side, doing abolitionist work in order to improve our data lives. Mimi Onuoha's work is also really interesting. I have a long list, and I'll stop there.
We're gonna have to get that list and publish it so that we can highlight all these women. I want to give Aerica Harrison and Aerica Shimizu Banks a chance to also answer that question if you'd like to. But I also want us to dig into this this ethics issue that's happening at Google, especially as we think of the role of Black women and the kind of message that the Black women that Meredith has highlighted, what they're saying and how they're kind of going against the grain to challenge this sort of accepted pattern of bias in tech.
Yeah, I'm going to just answer your previous question really quickly because I love the opportunity to highlight just amazing Black women and their stories. And so two that I would just highlight who impacted my trajectory and journey. One is Phaedra Ellis Lampkins, who's the co-founder and CEO of Promise. She's a Black woman founder who is doing such great work for people, especially who society puts on the margins, and is, you know, the CEO of her company. And so learning about her really just made me realize, like, wow, we are out here and doing it. And meeting her was just really powerful for me because it was at a time when I thought, like, wow, maybe I can't do this. Like, these racist questions are coming at me every day and, like, maybe it's not possible. And meeting her reminded me how possible it is. And so her name should be everywhere, in my opinion. And I should have learned about her sooner. And then the second one is Lisa Golopter. I'm forgetting the name of her company right now, which is so bad, but I will put it in the chat afterward. But she's also doing super powerful work, especially for bias that people face in the workplace. And so she was another Black woman founder who is in tech and who's done very, very good work in the computer science industry. I think she's like helped create GIFs that we all use today. And so those are two Black women stories who need to be amplified. And then I'll come back. I had another, you know, story about the importance of storytelling, and but I can come back to that after the Google ethics question.
So my response to the storytelling question actually dovetails into the Google ethics story, the situation we're facing today. But to start, I want to shout out Dr. Brandeis Marshall, who is the founder of Black Women in Data. And then also Dr. Lisa Cook, who is expected to be appointed by President Biden to the economic or to the Federal Reserve Board. She would be the first Black woman to be appointed to this to the board. And what's so notable about her is that she is one of the few researchers out there, the few economists out there who identified this gap in innovation where Black founders, Black innovators, and women and other people of color, but especially Black African-American founders are cut out of innovation, denied their patents, denied a record of their achievements in this area. And that has, her work has been the foundation of my work for many years when I was a patent analyst at Google working on innovation equity issues. But in terms of storytelling, absolutely, storytelling is key and it's powerful. And I think in some ways, at the end of the day, you strip us down, all we have is our stories, right? We can lose our jobs, we can lose our titles, but we always have our stories. And working in tech and working in many companies, actually, sometimes we risk losing our stories. So for example, my situation at Pinterest, when I left the company, I was able to come forward about the sexism I experienced, but technically not about the racism, as if as a Black woman, I could separate the two, because there is a law in California's books in the wake of Me Too that that bans these sort of secret settlements where women were being paid off, right, and forced into settlement agreements and NDAs where they then could not share their experience of harassment. They could not warn other women going into the workplace of what they might face. They could not speak to their experience. So that law was established in 2018, but we are now advocating, I myself, along with IFOMA Ozoma, the California Employment Lawyers Association, and equal rights advocates are sponsoring a law called the Silence No More Act, which is actually, which has been introduced, which will allow anyone to speak about any experience in harassment, discrimination they face in the workplace, whether they've signed an NDA or not, because our story should always be our own. And when I think about my time at Google, what is just especially disheartening about what has happened to Dr. Gebru is that, you know, when I spoke up about racism in the company internally, I was rewarded for that. And I actually ended up giving a TED talk, a TEDx talk about this very thing. And it's called Our Stories Will Save Us, because me sharing my experience allowed for this turning point in my career and an expansion of equity, equity programming on Google's legal team. And yet in the situation of Dr. Gebru, just a few years later, the opposite has happened. And I think one thing that is at play is to what Meredith talked about, which is the money. And, you know, fixing legal issues is a lot cheaper than fixing issues in a heavily revenue generating product. And so Dr. Gibber speaking out about AI issues is very different than talking about, oh, let's expand the pipeline of law school students to the firms that we outsource our work to. And so the scale was very different. And sadly, I believe resulted in a very different outcome. And so what we need to examine then next is the link perhaps between capitalism or profit generation and race and racism and how those things are so closely linked. But in terms of what I'm hopeful for with storytelling, it's the Silence No More Act and hoping that others will be able to share their stories, both about their triumphs, but also the challenges we continue to face in this industry.
Thank you, Aerica. For those of you guys who are watching, thank you for being in this room. If you're on YouTube watching, please drop your questions in the comments. So that we have about 10 minutes left. So I wanna take any questions from the audience as soon as possible. But while I wait on that, I'm so glad that we're talking about the money. And Meredith, you talked a little bit about, you know, how AI is funded. Can we talk a bit about the money and where it comes from? You know, who is really bankrolling a lot of these companies that we see, and what is possible? How do we access the resources that will make it so that we can build scalable tech to completely shift the way technology is used today?
Ooh, okay. This is gonna be hard to answer this doesn't really have a short answer, okay? So let me take a stab at it nonetheless. Basically, we're talking about the military industrial complex. Tech is funded by the military industrial complex. Computer science funding in general comes from the government. It comes from the NSF. Math and computer science are underwritten by the government. In addition to NSF, there's a lot of DoD funding. And so you can't access it unless you have a PhD in one of the scientific fields that NSF or DoD recognizes as valid.
The acronyms for those who may not be from the States.
Oh, sorry. Okay, National Science Foundation and Department of Defense. So they're US government agencies. Most AI funding comes from here. So in order to get grants from these organizations or get contracts, you need to have the right qualifications. The right qualifications are in fields that are heavily dominated by men. They have very, very few women of color. So there's just no way to access it unless you have these particular qualifications. The other way that you can get money in tech is something that Aerica Hairston can speak to and has done a wonderful job at, which is getting private investment. Often you'll develop something at a university using government grant funds, and then you'll commercialize it and get private funding, and then, you know, go on and be a tech billionaire or whatever. So that's the pattern. There aren't a lot of ways to disrupt it because there aren't a lot of Black investors. There are, there are some, but there just aren't that many. And there aren't that many Black founders who are getting capital and going on to become, you know, Black investors. But Aerica Hairston, why don't I toss this over to you?
Yeah, so talking about the money, who has access to investing, who has access to raising such big questions? And I want to leave time for
the group. And I also want to make sure you get to talk about your fundraise and sort of how the color line played out in that process.
Yeah, so for us, it was without a doubt, one of the most important things for me was I wanted our cap table, so our investors, to be reflective of the population. Meaning if our company becomes $1 billion one day, I want to make millions for people who look like me and have access to that capital, which meant finding Black investors, which meant finding women investors, and finding especially Black women investors. And so one of the more creative things that I had to do, because at first I was only talking to rich white men, which was very bizarre to me. Twitter. Twitter was where I want to say like 30% or something of our investors actually came from, and where I found Black angels who were saying, I want to support Black founders. Another place was using the office hours of venture firms that I was excited about. So Backstage Capital, founded by Arlen Hamilton, I went to their office hours and ended up becoming, you know, one of their portfolio companies. But finding Black investors was challenging, but it is possible. And the other caveat that I will say, which I realized during my raise, is just because someone is a Black investor does not mean they are out here for you. And I had to learn that a little bit the hard way. And what I mean by that is not just that they will invest, but in terms of kind of the questions that they'll ask and how they'll help you out. And so have realistic expectations, but know that people who are aligned with your values are the most important to be investing in your company. And I wanted to remember that during our raise, to not sacrifice what mattered to us to get capital, but also to try 10 times harder to make sure that I had Black women investors and do whatever I could to find them. And so the way that turned out for us is I believe like 30% of also our investors are Black and 40% are women, which is unheard of for tech companies and their private capital. And so it is possible, and know that you can do it. And it is important to do that.
And we have an angel investor here in this conversation who could speak to a bit about, you know, about being a founder, an investor of color. Aerica?
So I try in my investing to make the link, especially, well, I should back up. The kind of investing I do is I'm an angel for social impact and social entrepreneurs. And so I try to make the link to my other fellow investors, and usually they are men, so fellow investors, about how a social impact or a social impact startup or company, it's not just the product they develop, but it's also the makeup of the founders. And that's a consideration that a lot of social impact investors actually don't make, sadly. And I also find too that it's a bit of an uphill battle to get founders of color funded, because a lot of investors, even in social impact, are actually more critical than typical investors in that they want you to be revenue positive. They want you to be making a profit already. They want you to have a product that's scalable, et cetera, and also fits a criteria of social impact. So there's almost an additional layer there of scrutiny, and therefore an accessibility for a lot of founders. But I try to help founders overcome that by participating as a volunteer and coach. But I think, you know, what we have to look at, we have to sort of scale out a bit and just think about the nature of money. And wealth is concentrated still in the white, you know, and at least in the US, especially in with white men. And so if we look at the biggest investors, Andreessen Horowitz, if Sequoia Capital, Kleiner Perkins, et cetera, these are predominantly white male run VC firms. And Andreessen Horowitz gets a lot of credit, for example, for I think having close to 10% Black employees. But when you have a company of less than like 100 people, is that really that many? And why is the bar so low? And again, to me as a policy person, this comes to a policy and regulation area of focus where there isn't a lot because it's private investment. And so the scrutiny that's say applied to banks and how they make their loans or how they, you know, how they review mortgages is not applied to VCs, to investor circles, and perhaps they should be.
We have a question from the audience. Sandra asks, what can be done to support and protect Black women as they disrupt the status quo? I feel like you might have a good answer for that, Aerica, but I also want to give it to Meredith and Aerica Harrison if you guys have thoughts.
I think Aerica Shimizu Banks can take that one.
Well, you know, one is by listening to us. And when I say listen, I mean, you know, join panels like this, you know, follow us on Twitter or social media, read our books, read our articles. But really, to really listen means to take what we say and apply it in real life. And, you know, so often, you know, I see that Black women are giving advice or forecasting trends, you know, on social media, et cetera, and then not getting credit for starting these social movements, not getting credit for being the mavens that they are. So always providing that credit Even if it's saying, I heard this, I got this idea from someone else, or my research builds on someone else, that's extremely important. And then support us in ways that matter. If it's donating to our organizations or employing our, you know, employing our consultancies, or, you know, investing in our companies, buying our products, and making sure that that's a priority. And I think there, I see another question here about decentralization. You know, to that, you know, we need to support building our own products and ecosystems that support Black founders. And like I said, so often with Black founders, we're not just building for our own community, we're building for the benefit of all. And so we need that infrastructural support to really rebuild, remake, and create new systems.
Couldn't have said it any better.
I want, because I know you guys are going to kick us out shortly, I want to kind of dovetail on that and talk about the Social Dilemma film, right? Which is the film that kind of awakened most of us to, you know, the AI, the power of AI, and how much we are sort of controlled by our devices. And there was a big controversy after the film came out, even though it was super popular, because many of the Black women and POC who had sort of provided some of this foundational research were not featured in or quoted in the film. It was still very much a white male story, with them absolving themselves of, you know, of doing any harm. So I think what you said, Aerica, about listening to us, you know, sharing this video from this talk today, really seeking out, we do have to be responsible for seeking out Black voices and amplifying those Black voices and appreciating them while they're here and have the ability to impact us. So I want to thank you guys for joining us today. It's been an amazing conversation. Thank you, Meredith, Aerica, and Aerica. And thank you to Mozilla and Spelman STEM program for having us.
Okay, thanks so much. This has been great.
Thank you.
Thank you.